In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Listen to me, Isaiah cried out to his people. Bold, courageous, uncompromising, assured. These would have been some of the adjectives that would describe the directness of Isaiah's command. The strength of Isaiah's conviction is displayed when he says, "My mouth is like a sharp sword." His willingness to pursue his mission is demonstrated when Isaiah says, "God made him like a polished arrow." The people of Judea were in exile in a foreign country of Babylon. They needed a message of hope. They needed a message of deliverance. They needed a message that God was still with them. But even though Isaiah assured them of a coming Redeemer, the people would not believe. They refused to entertain the prophet's message. They could not accept that the covenant was still in place. Because of their hopelessness, Isaiah felt in his own confession, "I have labored in vain." The people would not listen to him. The people would not believe him. The people saw only the quiver, not the polished arrow. Yet, Isaiah persisted. "Listen to me" is something I'm sure most of us would feel uncomfortable saying. It sounds harsh, critical, and maybe too intrusive. Standing on the street corner is not for me. But then, where do you stand? Street corner evangelism may be a practice of the past, but the words, "Listen to me," are ever present today. And the brazenness to say, "Listen to me," has equally remained. What has happened is that we have lost the courage of our convictions. We are uncertain of our message, so we can't speak as a sharp sword. Worst of all, we are convinced that everyone has already heard, so there's no one left to listen anyway. No one is asking that we publicly embarrass ourselves by yelling, "Hey, listen to me!" But neither is it being said that "listen" can be replaced by silence or even a whisper. It is time to be honest with ourselves. We are called to share the gospel message. We are commanded to say to others, "Listen to me." In so doing, we must alter our approach to be reflective of our personality and situation. The place to begin is to have a self-understanding of what Jesus means to us personally. Next, we must accept the discipline of studying the Bible so we are knowledgeable enough, not a scholar by any means, but to be able to converse with others. And lastly, we must admit that not everyone has heard. Or better, maybe they have heard, but they have not listened. Perhaps we can be their new Isaiah. Other prophets have spoken to them, but to no avail. But as God said of Isaiah, "I will give you as a light," we too may be the new light that shines forth the message of redemption. It may be your words and your actions that cause an unbeliever not only to hear, but also to listen. But this will not happen unless we accept the responsibility to go forth as a polished arrow. Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. said, "We must work unceasingly to uplift this nation that we love to a higher destiny, to a higher plateau of compassion, to a more noble expression of humanness. In a world that sees much too much violence, it's clearer than ever this quote of Dr. King's remains true today. We must work unceasingly to uplift this nation that we love to a higher destiny, to a higher plateau of compassion, to a more noble expression of openness, of humanness." A lectionary text from John's Gospel shows Jesus inviting people to follow him, learning from him, and working with him. His invitation to them is stated as a simple and gentle, "Come and see." As he invites people to join him, he displays a deep knowledge of who they are. His choice of words is compelling enough that by the next day, his followers are inviting other people along with the same language. Come and see. No proclamation of what they should believe, no list of requirements, and no disapproval show toward the other side. The come and see invitation is about a relationship. Without debating the subject of these texts, we can see that this passage speaks eloquently about the burdens of serving God and the burdens of serving God that he calls us to do. The servant protests, "I have labored in vain. I have spent my strength for nothing. Yet surely my cause is with the Lord and my reward is with God." The voice of God promises that the servant will be a light to the nations. All of us have felt that weariness at times, and yet the fatigue doesn't end the call from God. Both aspects of being a servant, which we all are, by the way, as we follow Jesus Christ, both aspects are compelling as we watch the news and on a regular basis hear of horrible violence in our world. What we need is the foundation on which Jesus built his community of service, relationship. This means connections with people who think differently, and even express those differences passionately, but with the foundation of a shared life. That kind of service to one another as neighbors comes with a bit of discomfort and is not easily done. Being with people like us who think like us is much easier, at least in the short run. But we will never be well as a nation, as a community, as a church, until we hold on to the truth that we are all in this together. Left and right, Republican and Democrat, millionaire and homeless person, we will always have our differences. But we can create and hold on to a genuine sense of community. Too much division. So we say, come and see. People are invited to formally stop in and see a new home, remember an anniversary, or celebrate a minor holiday. Come and see. Don't make a big fuss. Don't dress up. Don't bring presents. Just come and be with us. Come and see. It's an invitation into relationship. Yes, there is almost always a good excuse for the invitation. At its core, however, it is a warm, welcome openness, a desire for relationship. Come and see. Andrew's inviting words summoned his brother Peter into relationship with Christ. It was a simple invitation with no strings attached. Come and see. And the same invitation brings many to Christ today. Listen to me. We must remain persistent if we are to make any change at all, if we are to reach that higher plateau of compassion. We must get out of our comfort zone. Come and see. Feel the love of Christ through his people. Feel the strength of Christ as we hold each other up facing such tragedy. Feel the power of the servant of Christ. Listen as we give a message of hope, a message that God is still with us. Feel a disciple inside each of you come forward.